Hi everyone. On this channel, I've covered the family trees of many European dynasties, and I'm starting to do Asian dynasties as well. However, I've never done a dynasty from sub-Saharan Africa, so that's what I'm going to do today. In this video, I'm going to be showing you the family tree of one of the most interesting dynasties in world history, the Solomonic Dynasty of Ethiopia. One of the things that makes this dynasty so interesting is that it claims to be rooted in the very distant past. The name Solomonic comes from King Solomon, so that's where I'm going to start. Now keep in mind that this first part is based on religious tradition, not verifiable history, but we'll get to history soon. So when I say King Solomon, I mean the same Solomon that is a character in the Bible. According to Judeo-Christian tradition, he was the son of King David and was the one who built the first temple in Jerusalem. Now there's a story in the Bible in 1 Kings chapter 10 that mentions a certain queen of Sheba who came to visit Solomon because she had heard of his great wisdom. According to that account, they talk for a long time, exchange some very expensive gifts, and then she returns home. But according to Ethiopian tradition, that's not all that happened. According to the Kebra Nagest, which is kind of Ethiopia's national origin story, the Queen of Sheba was named Makeda, and she had relations with Solomon during her visit. When she returned home, she gave birth to Menelik, who became the first king of Ethiopia. Menelik later goes back to meet Solomon as an adult and steals the Ark of the Covenant and brings it back to Ethiopia. The Ark of the Covenant is that golden box featured in the Indiana Jones movie Raiders of the Lost Ark. It supposedly held the Ten Commandments inside. So if you want to find the Lost Ark, you might want to start in Ethiopia. But let's get back to the dynasty. In ancient times, Ethiopia was known as the Kingdom of Aksum, and Menelik was supposedly the ancestor of their kings. This brings us to Zahakala, the first historically known monarch of Aksum. He lived in the 2nd century CE or AD, which is when the Roman Empire was at its height. During this time, Aksum became a great empire. It lasted about 800 years, and we know the names of many of its rulers. All of these rulers were thought to be descendants of Menelik. The last emperor of Aksum was Dil-Naod. According to oral tradition, he was supposedly defeated by an evil queen named Gudit, who had all the male members of the royal family killed. She was then followed by the Zagwe dynasty, which went on to rule Ethiopia for about 300 years. The first emperor of that dynasty married the daughter of the last emperor of Aksum in order to provide continuity. But in 1270, the Zagwe dynasty was defeated by this individual here, Yekuno Amlak, and this is where the Solomonic dynasty begins historically. Yekuno Amlak claimed that the last emperor of Aksum actually had a son who escaped Gudit's massacre and was hidden away. He claimed to be a descendant of that son, and therefore the legitimate heir to the emperors of Aksum. Now, it's impossible for us to know whether or not his story was true in a literal sense, just like it's impossible for us to know whether or not the ancient rulers of Aksum were really descended from someone named Menelik, and whether or not Menelik was really the son of some sort of historical version of Solomon and the Queen of Sheba. What we do know is that by the time the Kebra Nagest was written, Ethiopia was a Christian country, so it's likely that all these connections were invented in order to legitimize the rule of this new dynasty. So if there is any truth to it, that truth has likely been stretched and embellished, kind of like the story of King Arthur. But what we do know is that the Solomonic dynasty can certainly trace its origins to the year 1270. Now, we're not going to go through all the emperors because there were a lot of them. Instead, I'm going to give you a quick overview up until modern times, and then we'll go one by one. I do want to point out this emperor here, Dawit II. He was a descendant of Yekuno Amlak, and he reigned during the Italian Renaissance. In fact, the painting you see of him here is a contemporary one done by a Renaissance painter. He's important because from here, the dynasty splits into several branches, the two main ones being the Gondar branch and the Shewa branch. These two names refer to places in Ethiopia where the various branches ruled. So after Dawit II, we get five more emperors from the main branch before the throne passes to the Gondar branch. We then get three more emperors before an emperor known as Iyasu the Great. Iyasu the Great was a contemporary of Louis XIV of France and established diplomatic relationships with several European countries. The Europeans used the name Abyssinia to refer to Ethiopia. Following the abdication of Iyasu the Great in 1706, Ethiopia entered a time known as the Era of Princes, when imperial power declined and most of the country was ruled by local leaders. There were lots of emperors during this time from the Gondar branch, but they were mostly just figureheads. This changed with Emperor Tudros II. His reign marks the beginning of modern Ethiopian history. He claimed to be a member of the Solomonic dynasty via the Gondar branch. He managed to unite the country again, but his hold on power was still somewhat tenuous. He therefore reached out to the British for help, but Britain refused to send troops. This made Tudros angry, and he reacted by holding several British citizens in Ethiopia hostage, including the consul. Britain responded by sending a massive show of force to rescue its citizens. They sent 280 ships from India, which included 13,000 British and Indian soldiers, an even larger number of civilians, 44 elephants, and 40,000 other animals. The force landed via the Red Sea and took 3 months to march across the difficult terrain to the emperor's fortress. In the end, Tudros committed suicide, and Britain successfully rescued its prisoners. Britain did not stay to occupy the country, though, and Ethiopia remained independent. In fact, Ethiopia was the only country in Africa that was not claimed by Europeans during this time period, known as the Scramble for Africa. After Tudros, a descendant of the earlier Tagwe dynasty, claimed the emperorship for a few years, but then he was defeated by Emperor Yohannes IV, another descendant of the Gondar branch of the Solomonic dynasty. But his son and appointed heir died shortly before him. So after Yohannes IV, there was a power struggle. Ras Mengesha Yohannes, previously known as the nephew of the emperor, but after the emperor died, it was claimed that he was actually the emperor's son. However, Menelek II, a descendant of the powerful Shewa branch of the Solomonic dynasty, won the power struggle and became emperor. He is the last confirmed male line ancestor of the Solomonic dynasty. Early in his reign, the Italians attacked Ethiopia, but the Ethiopians were able to successfully defend themselves. Because Menelik II had only daughters, the throne passed to his grandson, Iyasu V. However, Iyasu was never crowned. His father had been Muslim, and there were concerns that Iyasu might eventually come to support Islam. So his aunt, Zuditu, became reigning empress instead. Her first husband had been the son of Yohannes IV. But because Ethiopia had always been ruled by a male, this man here, originally known as Ras Tafari, was made regent and heir. Now, even if you previously knew nothing about Ethiopian history, the name Ras Tafari is probably familiar to you. We'll get to that in a second. First of all, Ras Tafari Mukhanin was a member of the Solomonic dynasty via a female branch here. There was actually another person with a more senior claim through a different female line, but he chose to support Ras Tafari Mukhanin. So when Empress Zuditu died, Ras Tafari became Emperor Haile Selassie I, the most well-known emperor of Ethiopia and a dominant figure in African politics during most of the 20th century. He's also one of the few people in recent history to have an entire religion named after him. The Rastafarian religion developed in Jamaica in the 1930s. Rastafarians believe that Emperor Haile Selassie I was the Messiah, a reincarnation of God like Jesus. They also believe that blacks are God's chosen people, that African Americans are currently living in Babylon, and that one day they will return to Zion, which is Africa. Most people know a little bit about Rastafarianism because of Bob Marley and other reggae artists who were and are Rastas, or followers of Rastafarianism. But as for Haile Selassie himself, he was never a supporter of the movement. One of the things he had to worry about early in his reign was the Italians. They returned in 1935 for another attempt at conquering Ethiopia. This time they were successful, and therefore the emperor had to escape to Britain, where he remained in exile until 1941. The King of Italy, Victor Emmanuel III, took the title of Emperor of Ethiopia during this time. But during World War II, the British helped Haile Selassie to take the country back from the Italians. So Selassie was once again emperor from 1941 to 1974. In 1974, the monarchy came to an end when the country was taken over by communists. Although there was a short period when Selassie's eldest son was declared emperor, this was not considered official, and the monarchy was officially abolished in 1975. What exactly happened to Haile Selassie was not known until the 1990s, when the communist regimes around the world fell. At that time, it was discovered that he was assassinated by strangulation in 1975. In the year 2000, he was given an elaborate funeral. Today, his grandson, Zira Yaqob, is the most senior heir to the former throne. However, his cousin, Prince Ermias, serves as president of the Crown Council and officially represents the former monarchy when needed. So that's a brief overview of the Ethiopian House of Solomon.